All right. Good afternoon, everybody. Hello, everybody. If everybody could please find a seat, that would be great. If you can't find a seat, there's some additional seating over there. So welcome to our presidential address for this year's ABCT conference. Before we get started with any of our introductions of Dr. Hofmann, I have a few important announcements. First of all, be sure tonight to come to the party. We have a big dance party tonight. Make sure you're there. Also, if you're planning on going to the Wild Horse Saloon, there are buses leaving from the Magnolia Canopy and the Cascade Canopy on the hour and the half hour. The last shuttle returns at 1 a.m. Come and learn line dancing, network with your friends, and hear a little country music. Please, everyone, at this time, silence your phones or any other electronic devices that are going to ding or beep or do any other kind of noises. Just another reminder, the convention survey will be sent to you this Sunday via email. Please be sure to complete. The program committee is most appreciative of any feedback that you might have. Thank you. We also ask one more thing. At the end of Stefan's talk, please stay seated at the end of the address so that we can present Stefan with a token of ABCT's appreciation for his terrific leadership this year as our president. Okay. So I just have to pull up my slides. Bear with me a moment. So again, welcome. It is my distinct pleasure and privilege to introduce our president, Dr. Stefan Hofmann. In order to properly present our president, allow me to briefly review what probably is known to many of you, his professional accomplishments. So a little background on Stefan. He was born in Bietigheim, West Germany. He had rigorous doctoral instruction under the direction of Anke Ehlers and Walter Roth at the University of Marburg. He has 15 edited or authored books, over 30 book chapters, and over 170 peer-reviewed articles. But now you might be asking, what about the real Stefan? What some of you may not know is that Stefan is a music aficionado. In particular, some of his favorite bands hail from the late 60s and early 70s. The Beatles, the Doobie Brothers, and appropriately enough, Lynyrd Skynyrd. These are some of his favorites. And as you may also know, that era introduced to the language certain specific phrases, many of which have survived to this day. These changes in language have shaped our ways of thinking, something all of us can surely appreciate as cognitive behavioral therapists. In this vein, I thought I would help you really know Stefan better by understanding the 70s as young Stefan did, with the 70s lexicon the way he experienced it, through a German lens. This is completely appropriate to today's introduction, since Stefan regularly reminds us on the board that he is German through his words, as well as through, shall we say, his inflection. So how will we come to understand the 70s as Stefan did? Well, in doing my research for this introduction, I came upon an online 70s slang to German conversion site called www.70slangguttentag.com. But as any good researcher in this room knows, in order to really do this right, we have to translate our 70s slang to German and then translate back to English. So join me as I share with you some of my findings from my fictitious website. So let's start with the first phrase. Here's an easy one. It's one way that we would say, see you later. And it's in this context that we will see that some terms just simply don't translate perfectly. Sie haben einen Fleck auf Ihrem Schwanz, which translates to, you have a stain on your rump. Weird 70s in Germany there, Stefan. So the second translation, another popular one that might be used in a sentence at this conference as follows. I am really looking forward to getting the skinny on the DSM-5 at Dr. Hofmann's presidential address. Now, for those of you who have translated from one language to another, you'll see that sometimes small words require many more in the other to fully capture the meaning. Here we see that in the extreme. Ein vollständig und genauer Rücknug auf der Grundlage der Integration von vielen Kulturen für Daten, which translates a full and accurate account based on the integration of many sources of data. So finally, the third translation slide. Perhaps the most readily identifiable word introduced in the 60s, we might say that the band Stefan enjoys are indeed groovy. But here we see that sometimes pithy direct translations are just plain different. So we see it, Zustandingen, means competent. So, yes, Stefan, indeed you are groovy in a German way. All right, so now you have a little insight into how Dr. Hofmann came to view the world in the 70s through our little translation experiment. What about the less publicly known aspects of his lab? Every year, ABCT attracts conference attendees seeking to join the labs of members of our research community. There are surely members of this audience right now who are looking to become part of Stefan's research team. I'm here to share with you a little bit of insider information on the selection process for aspiring graduate students looking to study with Dr. Hofmann. Here are three representative questions from an interview with Dr. Hofmann. So question number one, Stefan is a very frequent visitor to the restaurant India Quality and is quite friendly with the owners. This one, the IQ test, is the first of three required questions for admissions to his lab. So one possible acceptance answer, I like the papadam, but the sag paneer was a little heavy on the curry. A rejection, chicken korma, huh? I thought it was chicken nuggets with the sauce already poured on. And then, of course, enthusiastic acceptance. It was all great, and I understand the dinnerware was picked out by a famous psychologist. Question number two. We all know of the rigor Stefan brings to his research program, and CBT has a rich history involving N equals one research, but with considerable well-known caveats. But moreover, there is a legend in Stefan's lab that he once advised one of his graduate students to, in quotes, never trust N of one research unless that one is me. Here, therefore, are some possible answers. Possible acceptance, this form of inquiry is suitable for the most preliminary investigations and possibly developing preliminary hypotheses. Rejection, I like N equal one studies. They're quick and easy to conduct. Enthusiastic acceptance, I understand that you, Dr. Hofmann, are the first and only individual to serve as a perfectly reliable and valid N of one subject. All right, so our final question for our intrepid interviewees. Final example, it's really the most difficult terrain for applicants. How does one navigate the turbulent water of musical taste that may not entirely reflect your own generation without also offending the interviewer? Well, let's see how this one goes. So one possible acceptance, I like some of the new stuff from the Foo Fighters and mix it up with some classical from time to time. An enthusiastic acceptance, the Beatles and Doobie Brothers are all I listen to. But oh wait, what happened? Because those are also my dad's favorites. Oh. So close. Some additional crucial facts about Stefan. He loves to travel, as shown here, a picture from his recent trip to the Galapagos Islands. His family is truly central in his life, as seen in this lovely photo with his wife and sons. He's great at, I guess, entertaining children. And as if you hadn't fully known or appreciated from this talk so far, Stefan regularly reminds us, he is from Germany, as this picture clearly illustrates. And, whoops. I want to also remind you that this joke is, while not necessarily culturally sensitive, it's not completely culturally insensitive either, given my own background. All right. Finally, and perhaps most important, for this introduction, Stefan has been a great president for this organization. I will speak on behalf of the board when I say it has been an honor to serve under his leadership. Please join me now in a very warm welcome for Dr. Stefan Hofmann. I'm having trouble getting this to go. There we go. All right. I'm sorry I didn't set it up right.
That's quite okay. All right. Okay. While we do that, the microphone is not working. Yeah, here we go. Thank you. Dean, this is really quite sweet. And I stood behind him so I could kick his butt in case he said something outrageous, but he got away with it. So let's see. Sorry. Boy, your laptop is slow, MJ. Okay. Well, it's a real privilege and honor to a slightly intimidating crowd, so Thank you very much for providing me the opportunity to be here.
It moved when you got the hug there.
So, okay, thank you. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right. So I'm really quite honored to be here. So I'm going to discuss the future of CBT in the age of the DSM-5. I thought I keep it sort of a circumscribed, pretty, you know, concrete topic. When we talk about diagnosing nosology, we often use the phrase "carving nature at its joints." So just in the spirit of the season, we kind of use the DSM or mental disorders like a turkey that we carve at meaningful juncture points to derive these pieces that the family is fighting over. So similarly, we are trying to make sense of the complexity of mental illnesses and then categorize them into neat categories that are now published in the DSM-5. And there are a number of reasons for classifying. The obvious ones are that we need a language to reliably assess patients and to communicate with one another and with also insurance companies, obviously. We also want to advance science and understand further the psychopathology, and we obviously also want to optimize and tailor existing treatments to develop new interventions. Now, the latter two objectives have not been met, really, and the DSM-5 also acknowledges this, that we're not quite there yet. The diagnoses are not directly assigning treatment options, and also the advancement of science is fairly limited with a new edition of the DSM-5. And in fact, when you look at the number of DSM categories over the years, they seem to be rather arbitrary, and it's for some reason a drop from the DSM-4 to the DSM-5. Diagnosis categories disappear, reemerge, are combined. It's fairly arbitrary, as you all know. And as a result, the DSM-5 is treated these days very much like a piñata. And just like any piñatas, do a few piñatas for my boys. They will enjoy that. We use bats to treat these piñatas. That's a cute one, isn't it? And as two possible bats, I chose the Yankees bat and a Boston Red Sox bat, and for obvious reasons, the Boston Red Sox bat is a lot bigger than the New York Yankees bat. So some of the fiercest batters include Robert Spitzer, the former chairman of the DSM-3, Alan Francis, the former chairman of the DSM-4 task force, who also happens to be the author of a popular book called Saving Normal, an insider revolt against outdiagnosis, DSM-5, Big Pharma, and the medicalization of ordinary life. Frank Farley, former president of the American Psychological Association, Division 29 of the APA, British Association of Counseling Psychotherapy, and Thomas Insel, the current NIMH director. And there, as you all know, there was an interesting exchange between Insel and Kupfer on the DSM-5. Now, there are some very obvious and valid criticisms. One being, in a way, we are pathologizing normality by using very arbitrary cut points. We are overly symptom focused rather than ignore etiology. There's clearly poor reliability of many of the diagnoses, including GAD and MDD. The not otherwise specified category is a problem. At some point, I was an advisor to the DSM-5, so my job was really just to criticize and not to really offer too many constructive comments. And
Michel Kresk, in case you're here, sorry about that. So the and as part of the, this discussion, we thought that we should subcategorize not otherwise specified categories, and then we ended up with an extra category called NOS-NOS, which really doesn't make much sense. Then there's the problem of comorbidity, as you're all familiar with, and many other problems, such as financial problems. It is a very well-selling book, number 3 on the Amazon bestseller list ranking, and yes, Benjamin, even more so than Harry Potter. Then lack of transparency, political problems, there are pet interests, and there's also sort of often a sort of a hidden big pharma plot idea. I can reassure you that my sense is that the big pharma plot and many of the other criticisms are not valid, and the American Psychiatric Association has been going through length to limit or even exclude these financial interests from outside. There are a few alternatives, and I'm two of those alternatives I'd like to discuss in a bit more detail, in particular how it relates to what we do. There's obviously RDoC, and I hope you all heard Varda Schoenhorn discussing RDoC, called Research Domain Criteria. In case you have not heard of RDoC, you will hear about RDoC very soon. There's a strong initiative by the NIMH, and in fact, any grants submitted to NIMH need to inform RDoC. The idea is that there are basic dimensions of functioning across multiple analyses, such as fear, anxiety, approach behaviors, etc., that cut across the various DSM disorders, and the goal here is to translate this progress that people have made in behavioral and neuroscience to improve the understanding of psychopathology and develop new and tailored treatments. And this is, I think, a good starting point. At the same time, it might leave out other approaches. Another interesting idea, and my friend Rich McNally pointed me to it, it has been introduced by Borsbaum, which sort of questions whether or not there is, in fact, such a latent construct called depression or schizophrenia or et cetera. And perhaps this is, these are just autonomous, interrelated symptoms that somehow settle into a pathological state. If you're curious about that, I'm happy actually to point you to it, so the causal system approach idea. Do we have in our field something that might be related to RDoC, but not so much in basing it on neuroscience, and also is related to sort of the idea that there are symptoms that settle into a pathological state? And I believe we do have such an idea. Such a model. So my talk will cover two main questions. Number one, is there an existing theoretical framework that we could use as a basis to build a what I would call treatment-relevant classification system? And secondly, what new treatments could we develop based on such a classification system? Now, if the answer to my first question would be no, then my talk would be over now, and so the answer would be obviously yes, and I think we have such a system and we can derive specific treatments from such a system already. The basic idea of this theoretical framework is at the heart of what we do and dates back to the beginnings of human thinking, and Epictetus, a Stoic Greek philosopher, as you all know, once said, people are not moved by things, but the view they take of them. It's a very insightful idea that the emotional response is not a direct result of the stimulus, but it's a result of the cognitive appraisal of the stimulus. And obviously, this is sort of at the core of what cognitive therapy is and what we do. We can expand this very idea a bit by subdividing emotional response into subjective experience, physiological response, behavioral response that we might call the interrelationship as we might define it as a syndrome of a mental disorder. And if we now also, we know that there are maladaptive beliefs, schemas about the world, the self, the future, that also contribute to this relationship and that moderates the influence of the trigger on these maladaptive cognitive processes. And we also know that attentional processes are involved. We also know that there are positive feedback loops that that settle these components into what Borsbaum would describe a pathological state. And we have what I would call a generic CBT model. Interestingly, CBT is clearly a success story in our field in psychiatry. And in this review, we examined the number of meta-analyses. These are not single studies. These are meta-analyses that use cognitive behavior therapy for the range of disorders. As you can see, there's a dramatic increase, especially since 2003, when meta-analysis became also quite more popular. And so, meaning in 2009, we had close to 50 meta-analyses using CBT for all sorts of different mental disorders. What kind of disorders were targeted? Now, this is my interesting, this is the point that I'm trying to make. We are all confined by the DSM-5. We look at meta-analysis for anxiety disorders, depression, chronic fatigue syndrome, bipolar disorder, and the likes, eating disorders. Sometimes we look at populations, but primarily we're very much confined by the DSM-5 categories. It is actually quite remarkable, despite that, despite these arbitrary cutoffs, arbitrary criteria that the DSM is using, and that is primarily based on a rather reductionistic, some people would say, medical model idea, we're doing pretty well. CBT is often more effective, most of the time, at least as effective as pharmacotherapy. So back to my initial question, can we now derive a system based on this generic CBT model that we could use as what I would call a treatment-relevant classification system? And the components of the system is directly linked to the model that I presented earlier. Triggers. Some people will respond to external triggers, others and situational triggers, others will respond more to cognitive triggers, others will respond more to physiological triggers, such as heart rate. Spider-phobic person is not so concerned about his or her heart rate. They would scan the environment for spiders, and spider would trigger the anxiety cycle. And other individuals might be more concerned about the heart rate. For example, cognitive biases, people differ in the kind of biases they show. Some people show an early, some people show a later cognitive bias, others show a presence or absence of, say, attention interpretation, memory biases, degree of engagement, disengagement. Again, my point here is that people differ on these aspects. Beliefs and schemata, self-perception, habitual cognitive styles, such as cognitive appraisal strategies. Some people are more able, others less able to use what some people call mindfulness approaches, acceptance approaches. Some people are better, others are worse in using suppression strategies, rumination, worrying. People differ in a number of personality dimensions that are linked to pathological states, such as perfectionism, distress tolerance, anxiety sensitivity, behavioral inhibition. This is not an exhaustive list, but rather some examples that pop into my mind as I was writing this. Effective responses obviously include some people will respond with positive, others with negative emotional responses to even the same triggers. And some emotional responses that are obvious are fear, anger, sadness, disgust, shame. And physiological arousal differs between individuals. Some show an increase, other decrease of autonomic arousal. Some show blushing response, other vasovagal response. And certainly people differ in the behavioral and avoidance strategies. Some people show more experiential, cognitive, behavioral avoidance. Others more overt, others more covert strategies. Safety signals are more present in some, less present in others. Distraction. I'm going to discuss, I could discuss all of these components. I'm going to focus on four of those, on triggers, habitual cognitive styles, affective response, and exposure and avoidance strategies. I'm going to both present data to which that support the idea that these dimensions or components are important in pathological states, and more importantly, then I'm going to discuss to what extent they could be used as a way to reclassify individuals, even within a diagnostic category. Let me start out by discussing triggers, habitual cognitive styles, and affective responses. Emotions are difficult, and I would fill more than certainly one lecture to discuss emotions, but most emotion researchers would agree on two basic core affects or core affective dimensions. An emotion is pleasant or unpleasant, and emotions are activating or deactivating. So we are often dealing with unpleasant emotions in our therapeutic sessions. So we talk about anxiety and depression, and we're not so concerned about pleasant emotions. And this is an aspect that I will bring up at a later point again. To what extent are these positive, negative emotions linked to individual differences? And here's a model that we developed recently that sort of focuses on something what I would call affective style. Even the same event can lead to different emotional responses. That is obviously the diathesis and genetic contribution are a factor. So depending on one's affective style, some people will respond more with a negative affect, others more with positive affect. Positive and negative affect are not, as you will all agree with me, are not just two points in one dimension, but you can have both positive affect and negative affect. You can have a mix of both. You can have, at the same time, however, positive affect tends to inhibit negative affect and vice versa. When negative affect becomes dysregulated, that often results in emotional disorders. One could also argue that dysregulation of positive affect might also contribute to emotional disorders, such as in mania, but I think primarily the focus in most of our, what we do is on negative affect, focus on negative affect and dysregulation of negative affect. This is going to be a distressing slide. You know it already. If you don't want to see it, close your eyes. So Benjamin, look and close your eyes if you want to not see it. So that's good. Thank you. So I'm going to tell you when you can open it again. So this is a distressing picture. Some of you will feel different responses. If I ask you, all of you will have some negative affect associated to that. But some of you will give me different responses. Some will say, this is a sad picture, or others will say, it makes me angry, or it's disgusting, or et cetera. Also, the intensity will be different. Some people will feel strongly distressed, others less strongly distressed. Now, I could also ask you in an experiment, I could show you pictures like that, and I could ask you to please feel the emotions as you experience them, do nothing with it. And this might be a typical instruction for an acceptance type approach. I could ask you to suppress the emotions that you have, to behave in such a way that nobody else could see what's going on inside you, and James Gross was speaking about that in his keynote. Or I could ask you to reappraise it. I could, for example, tell you that this is a picture from a movie taken where this is an actor, and this is not a real picture. And I want you to study also the technique that the director used. In these three different occasions, you will have a different emotional response, given depending on the instructions. This is sort of the idea of what we did with individuals, and interestingly, when we showed them, and you can open your eyes again, thank you. When you show them pictures like that, by the way, closing your eyes is also a pretty effective emotion regulation strategy. When you're watching these pictures, and I measure acoustic eye blink startle, so people wear headphones, so we present a loud tone, and we measure the magnitude of the eye blink startle as a result of the tone while you view a series of pictures. We observe that acceptance and reappraisal instructions lead to enhanced magnitude of Ibling startle, whereas suppression leads to actually to a lower startle response. This is actually quite interesting. It's sort of a no-brainer, but it's actually interesting because Ibling startle is supposed to be a fairly hardwired response that is not supposed to be influenced by simple instructions. Now, we could do this more in a more clinically relevant setting and view and ask people to watch, say, a distressing video clip. And then we, this, for example, the deer hunter with the Russian roulette scene, which is pretty distressing. And we asked them to deal with their emotions in a different way, to either accept their distress or to suppress their distress. As you can see in this slide, that is that suppression leads to a typical paradoxical effect in that as you the harder you try not to be distressed, the more distressed you actually will be at the end. Now, how does suppression and acceptance compare to reappraisal, these three instructions that I gave you earlier? In this particular experiment, we asked we recruited a group of public speaking anxious individuals, and we asked them to give a speech, obviously. And then before the speech, we asked them to anticipate the speech, and before the anticipation, we asked them to either reappraise the speech, it's not a big deal, there's nothing horrible going to happen, and so forth, or accept the anxiety, just feel your anxiety, stay with that, or to suppress the anxiety, behave in such a way that nobody can feel your anxiety, try to push it away. It's a fairly consistent picture that I'm going to show you now with this and the other and the following slides, showing that the harder you're trying to suppress your anxiety, the more difficult it gets, and actually reappraisal seems to work the best. Reappraisal in this condition, as you can see, was associated with the lowest, that's not the slide, it's me, okay, so I can't point to it. So reappraisal leading to was actually most adaptive in that it you were more able to downregulate your anxiety as a result. Similar actually with other problems, with other issues. So here we had smoking smokers, addictive smokers, to deal with their craving in different ways by either suppressing their craving or by accepting the craving or by reappraising the craving. And the reappraising is not so much the craving but rather what's the consequences of smoking. So we would say now these cigarettes that are presented to you, you experience craving feelings, but you should know that your teeth will become yellow, you will become impotent, your hair will fall out, and eventually you will die. But just if you like to crave these cigarettes, go right ahead. So this is sort of the idea. The anger, similar effect. So the suppression is least effective in dealing with anger. Reappraisal, most effective. Acceptance falls in the middle. Now, interestingly, this is a very consistent pattern. I could actually show you more that generally shows experimentally induced emotion regulation strategies. For those experiments, reappraisal works the best. Acceptance almost as good, but not quite as good, and suppression the worst. Then came out the meta-analysis by Aldao and Susan Nolan Hoeksema that examined examined cognitive strategies or emotion regulation strategies, generally speaking, as to what extent they are linked to pathological states. And not surprisingly, acceptance and reappraisal, the more people use acceptance and reappraisal, symptoms, they're associated with less symptoms. But the size of the correlation was quite interesting, showing that suppression is clearly has more of an effect, more of an influence on pathological states than acceptance and reappraisal. And by the way, other strategies might include also problem solving, rumination. So there are a number of factors that could contribute to it. Context, cultural factors, emotional flexibility. Some people are more or less able to adaptively use certain strategies. But I think most important is the distinction between dispositional and situational emotion regulation. And that now ties it back to what I said earlier, that if we can identify to what extent individuals use certain strategies habitually, dispositionally, we have a new way of classifying individuals. Situational emotion regulation works as well. Obviously, we get the effect that we often want, but dispositional strategies are often not measured adequately well. And when we do emotion research and emotion regulation research, we really don't know how people actually typically deal with their emotions. So we constructed a questionnaire to measure just that. This study presents this particular questionnaire that we identified fairly reliably three factors we call concealing, adjusting, and tolerating. Tolerating is more associated with acceptance strategies, adjusting more with reappraisal, and concealing more with suppression. And these are typical items of that. This questionnaire fairly reliably measures habitual emotion regulation strategies. Mindfulness is another emotion regulation strategy that has recently captured the attention of some researchers, including me. So mindfulness is difficult to define. It could be defined as a process that leads to a mental state characterized by non-judgmental awareness of the present moment experience, including one's sensations, thoughts, bodily states, consciousness, the environment, while encouraging openness, curiosity, and acceptance. Is pretty complicated, isn't it? But the point is, it's less emphasis on the content of a thought, but more emphasis on the awareness and the relationship to the thought. And mindfulness is both a habitual strategy as well as a strategy that you could influence through intervention, through experimental intervention, also through intervention in a therapy session. In this particular experiment, we recruited students and gave them a very stressful task. They were asked to inhale 15% CO2-enriched air, which causes fairly reliably very uncomfortable symptoms. And as you all know, it's a panic induction, reliable panic induction. We also told them then to suppress these feelings, and as you know, that has a paradoxical effect. We were interested in to what extent or what variables moderate this paradoxical effect of suppression when you feel really intense symptoms and unpleasant emotions. Interestingly, neither trait anxiety nor fear of suffocation nor anxiety sensitivity or distress tolerance predicted that. Only mindfulness, trait mindfulness, predicted it fairly well. So depending on how mindful people were, they were more or less able to be less distressed by the suppressive, by the instruction to suppress their emotions due to the CO2 inhalation. Now, mindfulness can also be taught, and in treatment strategies, in treatment interventions that use mindfulness strategies, we observe that they are quite effective for reducing anxiety and depression in particular. There's a meta-analysis in which we examined a large range of studies, a large number of studies that used mindfulness-based therapy without also including cognitive intervention or behavioral intervention, but primarily focused on mindfulness strategies. And as you can see, this is a range of studies from not just anxiety, depression, but they also included cancer patients, medical problem patients, ADHD, and the like. And what we observed was that mindfulness-based therapy effectively reduces anxiety in the overall population. The effect size was 0.63 at the bottom. And specifically for anxiety patients, we observed a very strong effect size. So it's particularly effective in reducing anxiety among anxiety patients. It's 0.97. It was quite dramatic, and I was quite a critic when it came to mindfulness-based approaches. And so this meta-analysis changed my thinking on that. Similar effects were observed for changing depression. So mindfulness-based approaches change improve level of depression in the overall population of studies, and particularly strong effects were observed among those who, among studies that included depressed patients. Now, including those kind of adaptive emotion regulation strategies, such as mindfulness approaches, could perhaps enhance CBT, right? And the answer is yes. That's what we when we compare standard cognitive behavior therapy versus enriched cognitive behavior therapy with emotion regulation strategies, we find a small but reliable advantage of those treatment approaches. Interestingly, when we look at to what extent emotion regulation predicts or is a consequence of changes in symptomatology, such as in this case anxiety symptoms, the answer is pretty clear. Changes in emotion regulation drives changes in symptomatology, not vice versa. Symptom change does not drive changes in emotion regulation, which suggests that emotion regulation is in fact a very important mediator in this picture. So just give you an interim summary before I dive into my second half of the talk, or second, third or so. First, emotion regulation strategies are effective at modulating subjective and physiological responses to affective triggers. Reappraisal is usually most adaptive, suppression least adaptive, the least adaptive situational emotion regulation strategy. There's a critical difference between dispositional and habitual, dispositional, habitual, and situational emotion regulation. Mindfulness is very effective at reducing anxiety and depression and also modulating stress, and training people in adaptively using emotion regulation strategies can improve psychotherapy. Let me now move to the last part of to what extent we can use exposure and avoidance strategies as a way to reshuffle the deck of mental disorders. And that gets me also into a into an area that overlaps significantly with neuroscience and pharmacology. When you see a person with an anxiety disorder, you often show them probably this slide or draw something similar. You say, well, this is your level of anxiety and you avoid and your anxiety goes down. And for that reason, because you avoid, you you never learn that there's nothing terrible is going to happen, and therefore you need to expose yourself to whatever you're afraid of, and as you stay in this situation, eventually your anxiety goes down all by itself, and it will take much longer, but avoidance keeps anxiety alive in a way, and by repeatedly exposing yourself, the anticipatory anxiety decreases, the peak anxiety decreases, the recovery, or the downward it goes quicker, and this is how your body works. And this is a typical exposure rationale that we give to our patients. And there's some truth to it. Exposure is, in fact, a new form of learning. Extinction is associated with exposure therapy. And we know on a molecular level pretty well how extinction is working. And we also now know that exposure therapy works through extinction learning to a great degree. During the learning process, two molecules bind to their respective receptor site units, so glutamate and glycine. When they bind to their recognition site, calcium channels open up. Calcium comes into the cell, leading to long-term potentiation, which is the basis for the biological basis for learning. If you replace glycine with a molecule called D-cycloserine, a little bit more calcium comes into the cell and a little bit more long-term potentiation occurs, meaning that the learning can be sped up. Too much calcium is not good, leading to neuronal cell death. Never really knew what it is, but it's not good. And D-cycloserine is a partial agonist. That means the channel is not widening not too much, so just enough calcium comes in to have a desirable effect. Now, this D-cycloserine does not work the same way as other pharmacological agents. So typically when we compare pharmacology, such as antidepressants versus CBT, we sort of compare two turtles that need to reach the goal, such as treatment success, and both turtles are really slow. And combining those turtles don't get you to the goal any faster because they're both slow. So with D-cycloserine, you really speed up one turtle by putting a rocket on. And now I woke you up. And so, and I bet my boys liked it too. So that reached the goal much faster. So this is the idea of D-cycloserine. It's not an anxiolytic. It doesn't do anything to your anxiety. It only speeds up the learning process. An early study that we did on this very phenomenon, we were able to replicate an early finding with specific phobia. In this particular study, we compared an abbreviated CBT protocol, 5 sessions, when people were receiving also D-cycloserine versus those who received pill placebo. By the way, it's a very small dose, so they do not know if they get a pill placebo or D-cycloserine. It's undetectable because it's only 50 milligrams. It's also the clinicians do not know whether they receive D-cycloserine or not. So it's a really beautifully double-blinded study. And what we observed in this particular trial was that D-cycloserine significantly enhances the effect of CBT. We observed similar results in other smaller scale study, in this case with panic disorder, with Jasper Smits and Michael Otto, showing again that adding D-cycloserine to exposure-based cognitive behavior therapy enhances the efficacy. A number of such smaller trials have popped up throughout the years. The green studies signal that there were positive effects of D-cycloserine versus pill placebo. The red study by Storch showed that the effect was not found. The point, however, was that there are, number one, there are fairly small-scale studies, and they were fairly predictable which study will find a difference and which will not find a difference. The Storch trial gave this the pill 4 hours before, even though we sort of know that it should be given around 1 hour before the exposure trial, and also it shouldn't be given after before every session. They gave it before every session, so we don't know exactly what the optimal dosing is, the optimal timing is. But the point is, there is the overall the picture looks fairly consistent, showing that D-cycloserine might have a positive effect. We most recently completed a very large-scale trial. The argument is often that, well, that it works for small-scale truncated CBT protocols. Does it also work for a 12-session cognitive behavior therapy protocol? The answer is yes, it does, but it's less dramatic. This slide here, I put up primarily to show that our response rate was very high, which means that we probably most likely had a ceiling effect. So as you can see, the response rate at post-treatment in both conditions was very high. We reached about an 80% response rate at post-treatment in those who received D-cycloserine augmented CBT versus those who received placebo augmented CBT had also very high response rate, and not significantly lower. The point here, however, we did find that D-cycloserine, adding D-cycloserine to cognitive behavior therapy, significantly speeds up the learning in those who receive D-cycloserine as compared to those who receive pill placebo. So the trajectory is significantly different. Now, back to why am I saying all that? How does this relate to the title of my talk? We were now interested in to perhaps predict who will and who will not respond to adding D-cycloserine to CBT. And we found something quite interesting and fairly consistent. We went back to the data and to other data and looked at the same results. It depends on how much of a fear reduction people have. If the fear goes down during the exposure trials, D-cycloserine enhances this effect. If fear does not go down significantly during exposure trials, D-cycloserine makes things worse. So D-cycloserine makes good exposure better and bad exposures worse. Not just that it's the same, but it actually makes it worse. We found more dramatic effects with other studies in which the most right-hand column, the white bar, was significantly below the gray bar. So now this opens up a new way of classifying individuals. By the way, before I jump into that, we find a similarly dramatic effect in that D-cycloserine makes things worse than pill placebo in another study, which we can explain with a similar mechanism. And that, so in this particular trial, we gave D-cycloserine to exposure therapy or pill placebo to exposure therapy to returning Iraq veterans. It's a very tough population. It was very difficult to treat them. And their fear, their distress rating did not go down well. We actually made it worse. Giving them D-cycloserine made their symptoms worse. Now, why is that? Exposure therapy relies heavily on extinction learning. Extinction learning is actually a quite complicated process. Fear memory is being activated, and then it takes some time for the distress to go down, and then a new learning occurs. Extinction learning is a new form of learning. If during the initial state of the fear activation, there can be reconsolidation of this fear memory. And if you stop this process too early, just like brewing a beer and you stop it too early, or wine, it doesn't really taste good. And that's what happens to folks who get who don't show a significant reduction in their fear. We actually, D-cycloserine is a cognitive enhancer, and it also enhances fear memory reconsolidation, and that's a problem. So, by the way, all of that also suggests that we are that we really need to work closely with neuroscientists and with also pharmacologists in figuring out how humans work and what we can do to improve their human suffering. Here we also used, in this particular study, we examined to what extent we can predict CBT response based on fMRI. And again, the idea is, can we use that perhaps as a way to reclassify individuals, to reshuffle the deck? Individuals were placed in the magnet, and then they saw a series of emotional pictures, negative scenes, neutral scenes, angry faces, neutral faces, or potent scenes. And they were asked to indicate whether they have seen this stimulus before, most recently. So it's a one-back task. It's a fairly standard paradigm in the MRI literature. Interestingly, they got out of the magnet and then underwent cognitive behavior therapy. And we were interested in whether we can predict pretest fMRI scans, whether pretest fMRI scans can predict treatment success, CBT treatment success. And we can, actually, quite accurately. I'm going to just move ahead with activation in the dorsal occipital brain areas and the ventral occipital brain areas. Activation from angry versus neutral faces predict fairly reliably whether people will respond to treatment. On the y-axis are the changes, the Liebowitz social anxiety scale changes predicted versus on the x-axis the actual changes. As you can see, the correlation was quite high. About 40% of the variance could be explained by activation of certain brain areas at pretest. So to make it look nicer, the left brain activation in this area predicts better treatment outcome. Less activation in those brain areas predict worse outcome. Again, this information could be used as a way to reclassify individuals to make them treatment, in order to derive some treatment-relevant system. So back to my questions, is there an existing theoretical framework that could be used as a basis to build a treatment-relevant classification system? I would say yes, emotion cognitive reappraisal models do offer such a system. And what treatments could be derived from such a classification system? Strategies to tailor interventions to patients, that is, goes into the area of personalized medicine and that are guided by biomarkers, enhancing treatments with adaptive emotion regulation strategies, such as mindfulness, enhancing positive affect, which is clearly underdeveloped in our field. We really don't really care too much about positive affect. We very much care about reducing negative affect, but it seems like positive affect is maybe at least as important, maybe even more important in some disorders. Increasing flexibility, attention training, which I have not said much about, but these are also aspects that are relevant here. And augmenting therapy with cognitive enhancers when appropriate, such as D-cycloserine. By the way, D-cycloserine is not sort of a miracle drug at all. We find similar effects with other cognitive enhancers, like yohimbine and cortisol. Why I like D-cycloserine is because the mechanism is very well understood, but certainly there are most certainly other drugs that are probably more effective in the future. So what should we do? So instead of sort of using a rather descriptive system to diagnose individuals, I think we should move to a treatment-relevant classification system. I think the future is actively participating in the scientific progress that moves mental health care forward. We need to expand, possibly change our paradigm that involves neuroscience and emotion research. We need to let go of turf battles. We need to, it's not cognitive versus behavioral, CBT versus third wave, all of that we should have behind us, I think. We should need to closely work with our neighboring disciplines, in particular neuroscience and biology. And we need to rethink the way we classify and treat disorders. And that is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for staying a moment. So it's it's my pleasure to present this plaque honoring Stefan for his service to the organization. I'll just read the inscription briefly. In recognition of and appreciation for your valued efforts on behalf of the Association for Behavioral and Cognitive Therapies as president 2012 to 2013. So again, please give it up for Dr. Hofmann.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh.
Thank you.